Hey there, what is happening, YouTubers? Thanks for stopping back into the channel today. Right here with the Rustbelt Mechanic. So today we are getting into some air conditioning work. We're going to be looking into the ins and outs of air conditioning for beginners. I've had a lot of questions from newer guys coming into the industry based on what kind of tools, what kind of diagnostic work, what kind of training they should get when learning air conditioning for the first time. So we're going to be jumping into the easy ins and outs of air conditioning systems and hopefully help you guys to diagnose some of these easy issues with some quick, simple tools. So stay tuned. So the first thing that we're going to get in today is the tooling. Yes, today we are going to be using our Snap-on PolarTech AC recovery machine, but not everybody's going to be having one of those. Yes, if you go into a shop, you're probably going to have some form, some version of an AC machine. Specifically, we are going to be working with 134A today. Yes, there is the new 1234YF systems, but this is still going to be the majority of the market today. So instead of having one of these $3,000 to $5,000 machines, a lot of guys are going to have a standard gauge set, which specifically this one does have manual gauges and everything on it with the hoses. So we'll be able to use that one just for demonstration purposes. Now the manual gauge sets that you are able to pick up off of Amazon these days, you can even get a pretty decent one with the gauge set, some injections, some dye, some goggles and UV lights, and even a vacuum compressor all together for like under $200 anymore. So they've got some really good deals out on those. You just kind of have to look around for them. You don't have to have something really high quality in this area just to be able to diagnose some of these AC problems. A good gauge set is going to be the very first thing that you need to look into. Also today we're going to be using a couple of random little things for checking the electrical systems with my Matco Tools relay switch set. So to be able to bypass some of the relays and the circuits to be able to test those as well. So today we have our 2000 Pontiac Grand Prix in the shop today. A buddy of mine, he's got some air conditioning questions about it. He says it doesn't really get all that cold for him and it makes some weird noises. He just picked this car up for his son not too long ago. So we're going to be jumping in on this one and maybe using it for some circumstantial things on how to diagnose the system. But before we jump into that, you guys need to understand how AC systems work. So let's jump over to the drawing pad. So here in this photo, we have just about the best rendition that I could find of a working air conditioning system. And this goes for just about every vehicle that is on the road today with a 134A system. We're gonna follow this thing through and kind of explain how this system is in a working condition. We're gonna start off here with our compressor. Our compressor obviously is a pump, acts like a pump. It's gonna draw the Freon or fluid in from the low side and then compress it to a really high pressure. We're going to be compressing it from right around 200 to 260 PSI and it's going to go out the high side line. Now the high side line is going to be a smaller diameter than your low side line that you see on this side of the system. It is split in half between the low side and the high side. On the high side, we're coming out of the compressor and our Freon at this point, you guys can see, is a high pressure gas coming out because a compressor, obviously in this respect, cannot compress a liquid. So we don't want to be compressing any liquids. It pushes the Freon out in gaseous form, goes in through our condenser on the front of the car. This is where our fan is activated or you are just driving down the road and wind goes through. At this point, with the pressures that it is at, this wind that goes through your condenser is actually able to cool down your Freon to the point that is able to change over to a liquid. Still at high pressure here on this side of the system, but it goes down to the liquid form. At that point, it goes in through our receiver dryer. All this thing acts like really is a point that it's going to be taking moisture out of the system. It's filled with almost like a little silicate bag that pulls any moisture out of the system. Going from there, it's going to go through our expansion valve. This is the other pressure point change in the system. The compressor was one, the expansion valve is the other one. It is pretty much like a really small tube that changes from the high pressure side to the low pressure side. When all of this fluid hits this really small hole and opening, it kind of builds pressure onto this side. That's what helps to build the pressure. After it gets through that really tiny opening, all of a sudden the pressure is instantly released into the low pressure side. At that point, we are at a low pressure liquid after the expansion valve, this side of it at least. In from the expansion valve, we're gonna go through our evaporator core, which is inside the dash. Our blower motor is gonna be pulling air from the outside and pulling the air through this evaporator. That is going to cool that air off, because this Freon, when it is in this form, it's going to be really cold, and that's why our fins on your evaporator build up so much condensation, because it's actually pulling the moisture from the air on those fins. So changing there from the low pressure side liquid, as the hot air goes past it and changes to cool air that goes into the vehicle up here, it is going to change into a gaseous state. After the gaseous state, it's going to come out of our evaporator and in through the expansion valve. This is the metering side of the expansion valve. The expansion valve acts as a meter, so when it runs through this side, if it tells that it's running a lot of gas or is a little bit warmer than it needs to be, then it's going to close down the pintle on the high pressure to low pressure switch side to not allow maybe as much fluid or Freon through. At this point, if it has not enough, it's going to open the system. When it opens that pintle, it's going to allow more liquid to come in through here till the point where this is happy at the medium in which it sees either from the liquid to the gaseous state. It still needs to stay in this gaseous state, obviously then going back into where we started from the compressor. So in a nutshell, this is the general idea of an air conditioning system. Now when we hook up over to our vehicle, our connection points are going to be right here at the low side port, which is just before going into the compressor. And it also is going to be right about here, just before going into the expansion valve on that part of the system. High pressure reading side and the low pressure reading side there. From that point, we will be referencing back and forth to this diagram to figure out some of the issues that we see to some of the pressures that we might see as well. So let's jump over to the car and see what kind of issues that we have first off, and what I like to go through with the diagnostic process. Now, first things first, we're going to be hooking up our AC lines to the car, and then we're going to be starting it and running it with the AC on to get an initial reading from our gauges to see what is working and what is not working in the system. So let's get these hooked up and show you guys where those go. All right, so we have our lines all hooked up. Our low side line is hooked up to the larger line, but the smaller port there on the back side, just before the evaporator. And then our high side line is on the line that goes from the expansion valve up to the condenser area up in here. So our high side point is right in this area. So we have this hooked up and our valves are opened. Now we're gonna go over to our gauges. And like I said, yes, this is a machine, but this can act like just the normal gauge set for our diagnostic purposes. So with this one, we can see where our pressures are at just an idle point. Here in the shop right now, it's about 94 degrees. It's a pretty hot day outside. So with relative humidity and the temperature that you're in at an idle position, with a fairly filled system, something that has about the right amount, you're gonna have matching pressures to the temperature based on the relative humidity in the air. So it might make it seem a little bit higher the more humidity there is. So right now, our pressures are right about 92 evenly on both of these. So between 90 and 95. So I'm gonna say that this system probably has just about the right amount of Freon in it, just from these initial readings. So now we're gonna turn the vehicle on, turn the compressor on, and we're gonna see what kind of readings that we have based on this. And you saw that the pressures rose really high all of a sudden. That was because I had the valves open, which joined the low pressure to the high pressure side. You don't want that. You want the valves to be closed so they can read their individual pressures from the high pressure to the low pressure side. So this is at a normal operating level. The compressor is on, the clutch is engaged, and the compressor is turning. So at this point, we can see our low side is right around 30 PSI. That is a normal operating level for a low side of the AC system. Now our high pressure side, we can see that we're running right around 200 or so PSI. We're at, well, 175 to 200. That might be a little bit on the low side from what we're used to seeing, but the fans are also running. That is a big indicator whether your fans are running or not. So this is a normal operating condition for this vehicle. Now I checked our temperature at the vents inside of the vehicle, and coming out of the vents right now, it's right at 73 degrees. Now, judging by the fact that our shop right now is at like 93, 94 degrees, that's gonna be a pretty darn good working system. This system might have a little bit of moisture in it, or we might have an issue with our clutch, because I can hear in the background that when the clutch does disengage, it is a little bit on the loud side. So now we're gonna run into a couple of circumstances here. I'm gonna put the car through to get you guys an idea of what happens when certain things may act up. Sorry, it might be a little bit hard to hear, but I'll speak up with what I can. I have swapped out our AC compressor relay right here for one that is switched. So at this point, if I had an AC compressor not engaging, I want to see whether it's going to be engaging or not based on if it is capable or not with the electrical system. So now I'm going to switch this on right here. I'm going to be able to switch our switch to the on position, and you could hear our clutch re-engages. So at that point, I know this is the control side of the relay that it's going to be actuating. I know that the control side system and the power side system obviously is going to be working for a compressor clutch, and it is able to work. So that there is going to rule out anything electrical on the power side of the system. Now we may still have an issue with a pressure switch, which won't allow this to engage properly, but I know that the electrical system has the capability of working. So wiring wise, the system is in good working condition. All right, so now that we know our electrical side is working, in a normal operating condition, we switch our AC light on the dash, and our compressor clutch engages normally. At this point, if we still have an issue, that's where we need to go to our gauges. So we've got our gauges right here, and we're gonna kind of zoom in here to see what kind of an issue we have going on right at this point. Now on this one, we can see our high side is hovering right around 200 PSI. So obviously from what I was saying earlier, that's gonna be about a normal operating condition. And we can see that our low side, it's running at about 70 PSI. Now I go inside, and obviously our AC is not really that cold. It's a little bit on the chilly side, but it's not nearly what it should be. Now this is gonna be about what it looks like when you have an expansion valve issue. Let's go over to the diagram and see what I'm talking about on that one when we have these pressures. So in this circumstance, like I was saying, our points of reference are here and here, which is where we have our gauges hooked up. If we have an expansion valve in this certain situation that is staying slightly open, we've got a higher pressure coming in from this area, we can tell that our expansion valve is stuck more into the open pintle position. Our higher pressure side is, you know, about normal. It's still able to run higher pressure than what it is after the metering system, but on the low side, it's gonna be getting a lot more of the low pressure side liquid that is forced in through the condenser, and that is meaning that it's not able to cool off nearly as much. When it's not able to go from a liquid to a gas, that means it is not cooling properly. So we are getting too much liquid into this side of the expansion valve, and that's why we are seeing too much pressure come up at the expansion valve side. So in this circumstance, it was pretty easy to be able to diagnose something like that, in which when this is stuck open slightly, then we're gonna see a little bit too high of pressures in the expansion valve. Now let's look at another situation. So now in this circumstance, we're seeing our low pressure operating normally, but our high pressure is going quite high. We're gonna get this to zoom in again here, zoom in correctly. So we can see our high side going in quite high there. So that is a real issue. Now I can look down visually and see that our fans are not coming on. I have this one hooked up, so we have a switch on our fan relay. So now we're gonna see what happens when I turn the fan on. So we've turned our radiator fan on, And then we can see our high pressure dropping immensely. We're dropping down past down 300, down to 250. Now we'll probably start feeling the AC system on the inside start to cool off. Now, this is gonna be the situation when somebody comes in and says, hey, I've got an intermittent overheating issue. My AC only works when I start moving. Now, obviously, this is gonna be because you only have air moving through your, when the car is moving, if the radiator fan itself isn't working. So when I shut off the radiator fan again, turn it off there, now we're gonna start seeing this high pressure side start to rise again. At this point, we are not changing our high pressure Freon over from a gas to a liquid form because we're not cooling anything off going through that radiator. It's not doing any kind of cooling purposes unless right here when I switch the fan unit on. Let's go see that one over on our picture. So when our fan is not in the running position, you know, we're not actually blowing air through our condenser, we have this high pressure gaseous Freon coming in through our condenser. The fan is supposed to cool it off, and then that changes it over into our liquid state, which also kind of drops the pressure. When you go from a gas to a liquid, pressure is also going to drop. Then we're going to go in through our dryer and up into our expansion valve. If the fan is not working, this Freon is going to stay in the high pressure gaseous state. Once we get to there, we're building up a lot of extra pressure. Our port is right here. When we build up that extra pressure, because we're not changing states of the Freon, that's when we get too much buildup right here. We get too much buildup of our Freon in that gaseous form right here at the expansion valve. When you get too much pressure buildup, then we end up not having the correct amount of metering coming through our expansion valve, and then also not being able to cool off on the low pressure side because we have way too high a pressure on this portion. Our compressor is not able to pump anymore because we're already too high a pressure, so it's not needing to compress anymore, and AKA it's not pulling from that. It's just a big circle. If we've got too much of a build up here, obviously the rest of the system isn't going to flow in its circular form correctly. Now that was just a couple of circumstances in which you could use a simple gauge set and either some jumper wire or some relay bypasses to be able to fool the system into working correctly to diagnose whatever issues that you may have in your air conditioning system. Now there's a whole bunch of other issues that you may have with plugged systems, other things not working like a compressor not putting out a correct amount of pressure, and I could go into a whole lot of circumstances for the next 3 hours, but those give you a kind of a sense of how the AC system works and how you might be able to diagnose it with more of these simple tools. Now, in the way of finding leaks, if you find out that your system is low on pressure, you guys don't have enough Freon in your system, then you need to find the leak. The AC information for most vehicles are either right here on the front bolster portion of the engine or up in the hood area. Some of the GMs might even be back in the HVAC box side on the trucks and vans and everything as well. So it's going to tell you how much Freon, what kind of Freon, how much oil is going to go into the system, as well as what kind of oil the system takes. Now, pro tip on this one, you also have to make sure that you have enough oil in the system working correctly, which we might actually have that issue on this specific vehicle because our compressor is a little bit on the loud side. Yes, I know we have a clutch that is binding up when it's not engaged, so we know we have that one, but the oil in these AC systems is actually what carries it along with the Freon. If you don't have enough oil in your system, that is what it's going to bind up some of the moving parts, the compressor, your expansion valve, a couple of other things with the expansion valve and some other systems, but the oil is absolutely key. So you need to make sure that you're seeing enough oil in the system when you take the Freon out or you have it evacuated or you're swapping components out. That oil needs to be replaced. So say for instance, you need to look at the compressor and the specific insulation for that. Most compressors, when you swap those out, you're gonna be adding just right around 2 ounces or so of oil back into the system because in a normal operating state, that's about how much is held within that part of the system. Condenser, It's about an ounce, ounce and a half. Your accumulator receiver dryer is gonna hold a little bit more because that's what's pulling the moisture out of the system and holding the leftover amount of oil that's also in the system. The receiver dryer is also another one of those points in the system that's pretty important and a lot of the time overlooked. That is what actually pulls moisture out of the system. Any kind of water molecules or moisture in these air conditioning systems is the big failure point that's gonna cause things to corrode, cause them to bind up, not actuate properly. So any kind of moisture is what we need to get rid of. Now with this specific machine, like I said, this is a fancy machine. It's got the compressor built into it and it's able to pull a vacuum on this system. Now with gauge sets, it does have a third line that's able to come off to a compressor unit to where you can pull a vacuum on the system. Now, why would you want to pull a vacuum on the AC system? A lot of the guys somehow skip this step in the DIY because they just want to hook everything up and then we're just going to charge it with Freon. Now, when you have these lines open, obviously there's moisture particles and everything out in the air and you want to be able to get that out of the system. Let's go over to the gauges and have a look at this one. We can see how these gauges go down in PSI in inches of mercury here on this side of the gauge. Now at negative 30 inches of mercury, that is the vacuum point at which the system needs to be at to pull moisture out of the AC lines. At negative 30 inches of mercury, that is the point at which water in the system is at a boiling point. Water will boil when it's at a negative pressure or a vacuum. That vacuum in the system causes the water to change from a liquid to a gaseous state, and then that allows our compressor to pull that vacuum and pull any of that moisture out of the system as well. So any kind of moisture in the system is a big no-no. So that's why we always recommend when you pull anything out of the system or you open it up, make sure you pull a vacuum on the system down to negative 30 inches of mercury for at least 15 minutes to allow the system to boil off any condensation or moisture. Now, after you've pulled that vacuum on the system, the next spot in your process is going to be injecting oil and dye. A lot of oils that come in the market right now already have UV dye already built into them, so that's usually what we like to use. We have either injector guns like this one. Our machine specifically here with the AC machine from Snap-on, the Polartec, has oil injection already in it, so I can program it to inject an exact amount. These hand-done ones work just as well. They're really cheap, they're really affordable, and you guys can pick up these oil insertion things for like $20 or $30, depending on where you get it from. It has the graduated marks up the side of the oil injection tube, so you can tell exactly how much of this oil, PAG oil, or whichever your specific vehicle is supposed to take, you can tell how much you are supposed to be putting into the system. You inject this in through the low side port before you put Freon in it. Now, after you go through and you inject the oil into the low side port, at that point, now you are ready to put Freon back into your system. Now, with a professional machine like this, you are able to inject the perfect amount of refrigerant into the system. You're able to read the placard on the car, tell it to put that exact amount. It will take the weight on the tank inside of the machine, put that exact amount in based on the weight and how much it takes from the tank, and will fill it exactly up. Now, without knowing that, you really need to know and understand those pressures that I talked about early on in the video, knowing where those pressures are at with their normal operating port of the system. You don't want to go too much higher. That means you've probably put too much Freon into the system. You don't want to have them a whole lot lower and have your compressor cycling too much. That usually means that you haven't put enough refrigerant into the system. So finding that happy medium there, understanding the pressures and their working points in your system is definitely a must know if you're just using gauges and a pressurized can from the department store. You don't have to have this big fancy machine. It makes it easy for some of the newer techs and being able to understand exactly how much refrigerant is going into the car, but you don't have to have that. If you know how the pressures work, you know how your AC system works, and you know the compressor is functioning normally, then injecting your Freon at the correct amount and the correct pressures should be a fairly simple process and a whole lot more cost effective than one of these $3,000 to $5,000 machines that are sitting in most of these shops. So the DIY aspect goes up with the more knowledge that you have. Now, when it comes to finding any kind of leaks in the system, you find out that your system is low on pressure. Therefore, you've got a loss in Freon or refrigerant in the system, even after you charge it and you know that you've put dye into it. Now you can get out your UV glasses and your black light. This is going to make any of those leaks within the system illuminate very brightly, so you guys can find where that small leak is coming out at. Makes it a whole lot easier, a whole lot nicer. They also have UV additives for other things in your vehicle as well, for power steering, for engine oils, for even coolant systems, so that where you can add UV dye to be able to help find the leaks. But the Freon is no different. You're able to add the UV dye to the system and use little tools like this to be able to find any of the leaks. Like I said, guys, this was just a few certain situations in which something might have gone wrong in an AC system, and hopefully I gave you some information based on how these things work, how the AC systems function as a whole, so you can get into the diagnostic side of things a little bit easier in your day-to-day operations on your personal car or in the shop. This just goes to show that you don't have to have these fancy $4,000 plus machines to be able to do AC work. You can just have a gauge set and maybe some temperature things, some jumper wires, and you can diagnose these things just about as easy as anybody else. I know these things help out a lot for newer technicians in a shop, but like I said, not every DIY person can afford a recovery recycling machine for your AC systems. So hopefully this information has helped you guys out today. If it did, make sure you guys hit that thumbs up button. Make sure you also subscribe to the channel. We are just clearing over 40,000 subscribers, so I wanna give you guys a big round of applause and a big thank you for all of my great, awesome subscribers. I couldn't have done this without you, and we are going on to more bigger, better things all down the road. So if you have any more comments or questions based on this kind of AC stuff, you can feel free to leave those in the comments below, or you guys can message me anytime. I see a whole bunch of interest on this specific subject, maybe later on I might go into some advanced diagnostics for your AC systems, but for this one today, hopefully this gave you a better idea on the more basic side of diagnosing an AC system in today's 134A cars. I appreciate everyone tuning in. We've got lots more content coming up, so make sure you subscribe, hit that bell notification so you get notified when I come out with cool, awesome content, just like this one here today. I appreciate you guys tuning in, and as always, you guys stay awesome.